The video illustrates for us what happens when selfishness reigns in the world. Selfishness is one of those detours that takes us from fellowship with God and with our brothers and sisters. Actively loving others replaces selfishness with compassion. When we're more concerned about holding on to what we have than meeting the needs we see in believers who are hurting, our lives will tend toward hate and away from God's love. Stephen and Alex Kendrick write this in a book called The Love Dare. They say, "Selfishness and love are in constant opposition to one another. While love asks us to deny ourselves for the sake of someone else, selfishness compels us to focus on ourselves at their expense. Selfishness is like a disease that suffocates our capacity to love." Follow along with me in 1 John chapter 3, beginning at verse 16. I'm going to read down to verse 24. "We know what real love is because Jesus gave up his life for us. So we also ought to give up our lives for our brothers and sisters." Think about that. If someone has enough money to live well and sees a brother or sister in need but shows no compassion, how can God's love be in that person? Dear children, let's not merely say we love each other. Let us show the truth by our actions. Our actions will show that we belong to the truth, so we will be confident when we stand before God. Even if we feel guilty, God is greater than our feelings. He knows everything. Literally, He knows all. Verse 21, "Dear friends, if we don't feel guilty, we can come to God with bold confidence, and we will receive from Him whatever we ask because we obey Him and do the things that please Him. And this is His commandment. We must believe in the name of His Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another just as He commanded us. Those who obey God's commandments remain in fellowship with Him and He with them. And we know He lives in us because the Spirit He gave us lives in us." Let's bow together in prayer. Father, we come before You today to hear Your words. Words inspired by You, given to John to write for us, for our benefit, long ago. Father, we are brothers and sisters in Christ. We have gathered together to love one another, to encourage one another, to pass on through us the gifts that You have given. We pray, Father, that You will guide us into knowing and applying the truth in our lives, not just today, but every day, that others might see and know that God's love is in us. We ask this in Christ's name and for His glory. Amen. To truly love, we've got to understand what God has done for us. We've got to see God's love. And this was shown once for all by Christ's death on the cross. Every believer has experienced that love. That's how you got in. You heard the message of the cross. You heard that Christ had died in your place. He gave His life for you. And you said, "I've got to respond to that. I've got to respond to somebody that loves me that much. I've got to love that person." He says in verse 16, "We know what real love is because Jesus gave up His life for us." One of the purposes of Christ's coming was to show us what God is like. And when He died on the cross in our place, He demonstrated once for all, this is love. I sacrifice myself, my life for you. Everybody who has come to faith has been confronted by that love. I like the way Graham Hendricks expresses this in the song Amazing Love. He says, "My Lord, what love is this that pays so dearly that I, the guilty one, may go free?" When we encounter that love, it saved us. As we remember that love, it will transform us. If we allow God's love to work in our life, then God will do for us and demonstrate in us, these are my children. He goes on in that verse to say, since Christ has done this, so we also ought to give up our lives for our brothers and sisters. Now think about that just a minute. Everybody that's a veteran signed a check. When you joined, you said, "I give to my country everything I have up to and including my life." Because they don't mind taking that if they have to. When you got saved, God has the right to expect you to give up your life for another believer. After all, that's what God did for you. Someone has said the command to follow Christ is the command to come and die. When we understand God's love, the logical response to that is to be willing to give up our lives for others. Sometimes it's giving up our life with others. I remember reading in the story about what used to be the Belgian Congo and the rebellion there among the Simba. And I read a book about the missionaries that were struggling there. And one fellow that I met that was involved in that was Al Larson. And they were killing people for pretty arbitrary reasons. They went around one day, they were going to kill all Americans. And they walked up to Al, who's from Philadelphia. And, they're going down, and so they ask him, "Are you an American?" He said, "I speak English." And so they went on. You know, well, that was quick thinking. You didn't lie, but, I speak English. And so, but I read about these two guys. One was from Canada, and one was an American. And they were being held off in a different area in the jungle with the Simba rebels. And it came the day they selected the American to die. This had been after they'd been held in captivity 3 or 4 months. And they said, "You're going with us. We're walking down this road." Well, people had walked down that road. They don't come back. You'd hear the gunfire, and you knew that was it. And he and this Canadian had gotten rather close in their time together there. And the Canadian fellow said, "I'll walk with you." And so the two of them walked down that road so that one of them didn't have to go alone, dying together. That's a pretty extreme sacrifice, isn't it? But it is certainly reasonable for God to expect that of you. If God gave his son for you, is it not, and gave his life, is it not reasonable for God to say, "I want you to give your life to save others, or to give your life to love others so that others will understand"? Now, I know we ought to do that for the world, but the focus of John, from the Gospel of John, and particularly in 1 John, we ought to be willing to do that for the people in this room. You need to think about it in those terms. All those people are having birthdays today. Well, think about all those people. Think about the people. Would you give your life for this person? Would you be willing to substitute your life for that person? God has a right to expect that of of us. Remember, John 3:16 is in the context of 1 John 3. I know that's not a tremendously empowering thing until you remember that all that chapter is really talking about one thing. Remember what we studied about last week? There's a contrast here between Christ and Cain. He just talked about Cain. We studied about that in Sunday school. He says in verse 12, "We must not be like Cain, who belonged to the evil one and killed his brother. Instead, we know what real love is because Jesus gave up his life for us." Cain did what was the normal thing in the world. He followed the path away from love and got to hate, and it led him to kill his brother. He says we need to follow the path of Christ that says, "I'm willing to lay down my life for you. I'm willing to give for you." Now, that's the greatest sacrifice you can give for someone, is to lay down your life on their behalf. That's a tough one to do, isn't it? It'd be tough to say, "Well, I'd be willing to lay down my life for these other people." Now, most of you parents would be willing to lay down your life for your children. Some of you would be willing for your children to lay down their life certain days. It's kind of like, this might be it. I brought you in, I'll take you out. But to think about laying down your life for somebody else's child, or laying down your life for another brother and sister in this room to defend them or to save them from dying, that you would be willing to give your life, that's a tough one. And maybe it's good that we start out a little less than that. That's the next verse. He starts out a little less than that. Verse 17, "If someone has enough money to live well and sees a brother or sister in need but shows no compassion, how can God's love be in that person?" Well, God says maybe it's a little tough. I'm willing to die for this person. But if you're willing to die for them, you certainly should be willing to give to help meet their needs. That's the lesser of the sacrifices, to be willing to give. And maybe that's where we need to start. When we don't give to meet the needs of others, it's a sign of unbelief. It's a sign that we're not walking by faith. We're not trusting God by faith. And as he says here, it rightly challenges whether the love of God is truly in us, if I can help, but I don't. And he notices here, and in this translation it says, "but shows no compassion." Literally it says he shuts off his bowels. Aren't you glad we got translators to communicate what? But it's that this is the seat of emotion. And you have that feeling in your gut. for other people. When somebody's hurting, when you see somebody in need, when you see a brother or sister doesn't have food and clothes, it makes you hurt. It should make you hurt on the inside. And he says, when you shut that off, when you close that off, you say, I'm not going to be compassionate to that person. I don't want to feel that. I don't want to reach out to that person. I don't want to feel what they're feeling. He says, that's a bad thing. You shouldn't shut off that compassion. You know why? Because that's God's love in you trying to get out. It's trying to motivate you and say, I want you to do what I want you to do. The failure occurs when we close off our compassion. Sacrificial love is a mark of the presence of God's love within us. Sometimes we forget about what God did for us. He's going to come down and he's going to talk about the Spirit being within us in verse 24. But listen, Christian, the moment you got saved, God put his Spirit to reside within you. All of the love of God is channeling through you. All the power of God is channeling. We like the power of God channeling through. That sounds good. You know, I have power of God. You'll hear that all the time. But God is saying, I'm trying to love people through you. Don't look at me that way. He's talking about you. I know I'm included, but he's talking about you. God is trying to get that love that he put in you to channel out to other people. But we tend to shut it off. Well, how do we do that? Well, sometimes we violate the first part of that verse. Verse 17 says, if someone has enough money to live well and, what's the next word? Sees his brother in need. A lot of times we'll say, I don't see. I don't want to know. It looks okay to me. It's the idea that I am going to put my mind to focus on what are the needs of the people around me. Do you know whether anybody in this room has a financial need? Well, we all wear our best stuff. I wore my Alabama stuff today just to memorialize. You know, it's like coming to a funeral. But we all put our best stuff on to come to church. And occasionally you'll see somebody that you say, you know, that person doesn't seem to have enough of what they need. Now, it's not such a big deal down here, but where I'm from, there's a lady who used to come to our church, and the lady's got to noticing her coat wasn't in good shape, which in Virginia can be a killer. Literally, you can die for not having enough warm clothes if you get stuck and you don't have warm clothes. So they got together and they bought her a new coat because she needed something warm. We ought to be looking around to seeing, how's so-and-so doing? Do they have a need that I could meet? Is this person in need? Is there something going on with this person? And I could be the person that contributes towards that. We ought to be looking for. We ought to be seeing what's going on. A lot of times we come to church and we're busy about our own thing. We're busy about doing what I want to do. We're busy getting the Word of God for me. We're busy getting the worship so I have that great worship experience. Do you ever come to church and think, let me see how everybody else is doing? Let me talk to some people. Let me listen to some people. Let me observe what's going on and see where are the needs. Where could I be of use in helping other people in and around this church? What are the things that my brothers and sisters in Christ are in need about? We need to see in order that we might deal with that. Love has to be more than words. Verse 18 says, dear children, let's not merely say that we love each other. Let's show the truth by our actions. Love gives. A gift is an expression of love, not merely of our own. I love you, so therefore I'm going to give you something. But we've got to recognize it's God expressing his love through us. God gave us what we need to live on, and God gave us more than we need to live on. Maybe there's people in here that don't have enough to live on, and that's possible, maybe likely in a group this size. But most of us have what we really need to live on, and we've got enough we could help somebody else. God has blessed us abundantly in order to be able to do that. Giving to others can create a lack on our part. That's a problem. And that's why the next part of this talks about having confidence before God. Because if you give what you have to somebody else, you don't have it anymore. You can't have your cake and eat it too. You got to. If you give it, you don't have it. And for some people, that raises a problem. Well, if I give, then I won't have enough to help me. I won't have enough to deal with me. The lady that I was telling you about that got the coat, you know what the first thing she did after she put on the coat? She went out and found the box next door, the supermarket store type thing next door. There's a box where they collected things. She put her old coat in that so you help somebody else. Well, that's okay. You know, we were kind of hoping she'd hang on to that as a working coat. But anyway, she did. She wanted, she received, and she wanted to give. Well, that means now she's down to one coat. She had two coats. Now she's down to one coat. And so you say, well, if I give this away, I won't have it when I need it. I might need this down the road if I help this person. But practical Christian living, by giving to help others, puts us in a good position when we come to seeking things from the Lord. It gives us, he says, confidence before the Lord. It ought to be a scary thing to come before the Lord and to pray and ask him for things when we haven't been taking care of the needs we see around us. It takes a real height of arrogance to say, Lord, I've got to have more when I haven't spent any on anybody else, when I haven't met the needs of those around us. Sometimes in that case, our heart rightly condemns us. And other times, just because we've got that kind of heart, sometimes our heart wrongly condemns us. We've done the right thing, but we've not done everything, and we begin to feel guilty. And the truth he points out to us is that God knows everything. And God is the one who's going to make the judgment about our hearts. Now, that's good if I feel guilty. John doesn't point it out, but it's also bad if I'm arrogant, if I'm selfish, because I think that I'm going to get, and I ought to get, I deserve to get. After all, I am the blessed of the Lord. I am the one that God has showered. I obviously am doing things right. I've got plenty of money. God is pouring money at me, and I've just got all kinds of things, and I have no problem asking God for more and more things. We won't turn there, but Luke chapter 18, verses 9 to 14, raises the issue about, am I accepted or am I assured? Am I assured when I stand before God? Well, the story Jesus told was a parable about a Pharisee who dressed righteously, thought he was the most righteous person around, and about a publican. A publican, that's old word, that shows my King James background, the publican. The guy that was the tax collector is really what he's talking about. The tax collector who was working for the Romans, he's not even a good Israeli, not even a good Jew. He's kind of like a traitor to his people, a thief. And they come before the Lord in the temple to pray. And the Pharisees, he said this, I thank you, God, that I'm not like other people, cheaters, sinners, adulterers. I'm certainly not like that tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give you a tenth of my income. You know what his prayer is? God, you're lucky to have me. Thank you for giving me what you're giving me. I pray you'll give me more because I deserve it, unlike all these other people, for instance, like this guy over here who doesn't deserve anything from you. The tax collector, on the other hand, he wouldn't even approach the holy place. He stood off in the distance. I can see Jesus in the temple area watching this Pharisee pray and seeing way off over here, there's this sinner, this tax collector. And he doesn't even raise his eyes to heaven. He's just bowing down and he's beating on his chest in sorrow. And you can see him doing this. You can see this happening. And he's just so downcast. He doesn't even feel the right to pray. And he just says, oh God, be merciful to me, for I am a sinner. I'm everything this Pharisee says I am. And Jesus said, the sinner, not the Pharisee, went home accepted by God. Now, here's the thing. You'll be studying this week. You can be assured that you're in good standing with God and not be accepted by God. That's the Pharisee. He thought, if anybody on earth is accepted by God, it's me. I'm God's man. I follow God. I give. I do these things. God certainly said, and he left the temple thinking he was accepted by God. He had absolute assurance that he was. But he wasn't. Now, on the other hand, you've got the publican who was accepted, but I think he left not feeling any assurance of that. He came a sinner and he left thinking, I am the lowest, rottenest person in the world. I don't understand why God would give me anything. He was accepted, but he didn't have assurance. You know, there are people that are like that with salvation. They're saved, but they're not sure they're saved. They're saved, but they think there's something wrong with me. I've got to be better than I am. I've got to do something. I'm going to have to do something better in order to be saved. They have missed the point that all of us get saved by coming to God and saying, God, I'm just like that publican. I'm a sinner and I don't deserve anything from you. But I have heard about the love of Christ who died for me and that all you want me to do is put my trust in him and I'm believing on Jesus that he's the one that can save me. I don't have anything I bring, nothing I can give to you. I simply receive your love expressed in Christ and put my trust in him. That's how you get saved. But it's also possible for us to be accepted and assured of salvation. And that's where giving to help others encourages us to know I'm in the right standing before God. Actions can produce confidence before God. Actions can produce confidence before God. Verse 19 says, our actions will show that we belong to the truth, so we will be confident when we stand before God. Now, in this passage, there's two occasions where we stand before God. Most of the time when I hear the term standing before God, I jump all the way to the end of time, which may not be that long. But whenever it is, I think to that time, the thing he describes in chapter 2, verse 28, he talks about when Christ appears. When Christ appears, we're all going to stand before the Lord Jesus Christ and be judged, everyone. Everybody in this room, myself included, there's no exceptions. We're going to stand before Christ in judgment. Every one of us has that appointment. We've got a court date, so to speak. We've got a day when we're going to stand and appear before God and be judged. I want to have some confidence on that day because I know my knees are going to be shaking. But I want to have some confidence that God was at work in my life, that the Spirit of God really did reside in me, and that the love of God flowed through me to others. I want to have confidence in that day. And that's certainly in this context. But the more immediate thing I believe is when I stand before God on a daily basis and pray, just like the Pharisee and the publican did. You realize every one of us can stand before God at any moment of the day? We have the right, because of Christ, to come boldly as Christians before the Lord and ask him for things, to pray. And the determining factor of whether or not God is going to hear and answer our prayer is not our feelings, but our knowledge. There are some people that are so guilt-ridden that they cannot come to God and ask with any assurance that they're going to get their prayers answered. On the other hand, there are some people, they march boldly right in and demand from God the finest of things, because they know God would not want them to be lacking. And God knows the heart of both. And he knows who he's going to bestow his wealth upon. Verse 20 says, even if we feel guilty, God is greater than our feelings. He knows everything. That's encouraging. It's also a bit scary, because God knows everything about us. God knows whether he can trust us with his resources. He said, dear friends, if we don't feel guilty, we can come to God with bold confidence, and we will receive from him whatever we ask because we obey him and do the things that please him. I'm not a big fan of prosperity theology. Let me just say that up front, that God doesn't want you to be poor. God doesn't want you to be lacking. All you've got to do is name it and you'll receive it. You can claim it. Whatever you want, whatever you need. I think the theologian Janis Joplin put it best, said, oh Lord, won't you buy me a Mercedes-Benz because my friends all drive Porsches and I must make amends. There are some people, that's their attitude, that's the theology. God exists so that I can be wealthy. The only thing holding you back is your lack of faith. You just got to name it and claim it. It's not what God's saying here. That's not at all what he's talking about, is it? This is not in the context of me having more and more. This is the context, I see a need. And God, I am giving to meet that need. I have given some of my living, some of what I had to live on. I'm kind of like the widow that went up to the temple. She gave, in order to have a place to worship God and have the temple fixed up, she threw in everything she had to live on. There were others that were giving. They were giving a lot more than she was giving, but she was the one who'd made the great gift. When I give to help somebody else, it means I don't have food for me. I don't have that. I may have enough for me today, but what about tomorrow? God, if I share my meal with somebody, and let's be honest, most of us could share a meal with somebody and we both would be overfed. But I could help somebody. I could see that there's not needy. I could see that needs are met, but I'm giving away something that God has given me to live on, or I could consume it for myself. But let's say I give it. Let's say I give and say, God, you know, I was counting on this in order to be able to do this, but I saw this need here. And there's a great need there, and I met that need. And to be honest, Lord, I didn't meet all the need. I did what I could to help, but that person still has a need. Lord, if you'll give me more, I'll give to meet that need. I've told you before about Larry Burkett. He's talking about he had to spent $500 to get his furnace repaired. And a week later, it was acting up again. It was going out. He said, God, I just can't believe you want me to spend another $500 on that furnace. And he says, just like the Lord spoke to him, he said, well, what were you going to spend it on? He said, well, I don't know, God, what do you want me to spend it on? And God laid a need on his heart. He said, all right, God, I'll give the money for that. Well, he called the repairman. It was like a $12 part was needed. Just put that on. It took care of it. And so he got direction. God wants me to send this money, to give this money here to meet this need. It's God's money. God says, if I can trust you, I can pour out my riches upon you. I had a professor at Dallas Seminary that he just casually mentioned this somewhere in a sermon illustration that he and his wife had given away $15,000 to help people in Haiti the year before. And one of the other professors was talking in class. He said, I'm pretty sure the seminary wasn't paying him $150,000. He said, I can almost guarantee you that. And I got to finding out that this couple had determined they were going to live on what the seminary paid them. Whatever it was, whatever the salary was from the seminary, they said, we'll live on that. Anything else that comes in, we will make good use of it. And they kept a separate account. And whatever else came in, like if he went to speak somewhere and they paid him an honorarium, it went in that fund. If somebody gave him money, said, you know, when you find out there's somebody you can trust, if I give this person money, it's going to get to where it goes. Hey, well, in fact, some students would bring their parents up and say, introduce them and say, hey, you need to talk to these folks. They're loaded, and they're looking for some place to give money. God knew he could trust them, that Walt and Dottie were trustworthy, and that they would not spend it upon their lust. They would see that it got to where it needed to go. Well, when you get in that situation, when God knows he can trust you, then God will say, okay, ask me for what you need to meet these needs. And God will pour his money and his love through you. Now, you say that sounds a lot like prosperity. That sounds like the approach they take, but their approach is, so I can live better, instead of I'm going to live poor, and I'm going to pass this on to help others who are in need. Have you ever asked God for more in order that you might give to others and not consume it upon your own needs? 1 John 3:23-24 say this, and this is his commandment. Okay, we got to obey the commandments. Well, there's two right here. One, we must believe in the name of his son, Jesus Christ, and love one another just as he commanded us. Now, salvation is not dependent upon me loving other people. I'm not saved because I love other people. I love other people because I'm saved. I don't earn salvation. I don't earn a little more of salvation. I don't get a measure more of salvation because I love somebody else or because I give to help somebody else's need. It doesn't save me anymore. I'm not any more acceptable to God. I'm no more assured of heaven because of that. I gain personal assurance that God's love is working with me when I give up to help others, but it doesn't save me. I'm saved because I've obeyed the first commandment. Have you obeyed the first commandment of God, which is to believe on his son, Jesus Christ? Have you put your trust in Christ? Believe, and then look for ways to love other believers. Love follows salvation. Love does not pay for our sins. The hilasmos, the propitiator, Jesus Christ has done that. It's paid for. But God wants to pass on that love through us. Those who obey God's commandments remain in fellowship with him, and he with them. What are the commandments? Not the Ten Commandments, not talking about that. What are the commandments? Trust Christ, love one another. When we do that, we're in fellowship with God because God has saved us and God loves us. And he wants us to be a part of that. Obedience to God's command to believe and to love are signs that we fellowship with God and he with us. And thus we're walking in the light as God is in the light. The end of verse 24, he talks about, and we know he lives in us because the Spirit he gave us lives in us. That's why we love. It's one of the marks of the Spirit. We'll talk about more about the Spirit in a couple of weeks when we come back to 1 John and we look at chapter 4. We'll talk about how you know the Spirit is at work. But as we close today, I want to ask you three questions. Number one, have you trusted Christ? Have you trusted Christ? Have you come to the place where you said, I want him to save me? Some people have not really done that. For whatever reason, you misunderstood the message. You thought, well, I've got to trust Christ and I've got to do right. I've got to get this straightened out in my life. I've got to do this over here in my life. I've got to give this. I've got to give more. I've got to do this. I've got to be baptized. I've got to pray. I've got to read the Bible. I've got all these things I've got to do. And if I don't do that, I won't get saved. No, that's not the message. The message is that Christ has done everything that's necessary to save you. And that he is the foundation. When you trust him, he's going to put his spirit inside of you. God is going to come and live inside of you, and he's going to take the responsibility for obeying the commandments and put it on himself. And he's going to begin working in your heart and your life to produce his love for other people in the world. Number one, have you trusted Christ as Savior? Have you completely trusted him? You see, if you're thinking it's a combination of Christ plus your works, you've yet to put your trust in Christ. It's kind of the little old lady that took her first airplane ride. They said, "Grandma, how was it?" She said, "Well, it's all right, but I didn't put my full weight down." Well, sometimes we think, well, okay, I've trusted Christ, but surely I've got to do more. No, you're just building anxiety in yourself. You need to rest in Jesus in order to be saved, in order to understand that you are saved, that you're trusting him. Secondly, are you looking for need in other believers around you? I'm saved. Now let me see who in the fellowship I can help. Is there someone around that I can minister to, that I can make their day, that God will direct me, this is a person that you could help. This is a person you could do something for. You could be a blessing to this person. This person has a need that maybe it's a financial need. Might not be financial, but more than likely there's a financial need. There's a financial component to it. Are you looking around you for need? First, look here. Look around you at the people here. Look at directly. Look for the people that aren't here that come sometimes, and you're looking around. Look for need. Is there a need that I could meet in this person's life? It'll cost me something to meet that need. But are you noticing that need? And then the final question is this. Are you preparing to meet it? Are you preparing to meet it? It's difficult sometimes to find need because people tend to hide that. They don't want to let you know that I'm in need. They tend to hide. But if you watch, you can find that. But it's another thing to say, I'm ready to meet that need. I knew a fellow that kept $50 in his wallet. And the whole purpose of that $50, it was hidden in one of those compartments, was if he met somebody that was in need, he could give them that $50. He put back money. I knew another guy that they had a special tithe portion that they gave. They gave to their church regularly, but they set aside another amount to be used to meet needs. It's a special, he even had his own checking account, as I remember it. And he set aside money there, and the purpose of giving this money every week, putting money in here, was so when they heard about a need, they would be able to write a check out of that amount to help. They'd be able to take from that account and to help. Are you setting aside money to meet the needs of others? It could be a little bit every week, a little bit out of every paycheck. It could be every time you turn around, or you just say, well, I'm going to keep a $50 or $100 in my wallet. Some of you older guys, anybody besides me used to keep a $100 bill in your wallet? I see some, you know why you did that? Because in case you needed it, it was emergency money. Because that was back in the days when they didn't have all the GPS stuff. A tow truck would not accept a credit card a lot of times. So if you needed a tow, I could pay him. And everybody I know of will take a C-note, except McDonald's. They won't accept it now. But everybody else will take $100. Well, the idea is put some money aside. Have it on you. Have it where you can get it quickly. So if you see a need, I'm preparing to meet that need. I'm able to do this. Just like when you give to the church, when you take your money, you give them to church, you're setting aside and saying, God has blessed me, and I'm going to depend upon God to keep on blessing me, that this is not the end of it. God's going to keep on blessing. God is going to keep on supplying my needs, and so I can give, and I'm trusting God that he's going to supply. You see, it's a step of faith. Well, this is just a little extra step of faith. It's saying, I'm going to take some and I'm going to set it aside so that I can meet the needs of other believers who I hear have a need. And that's the challenge I think John presents us with in this passage. Are you looking for need, and are you prepared to meet it? Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the love that we experienced in Jesus Christ. Lord, it would be so hard to give up our life. Father, sometimes it's harder to give up our money. Lord, help us to see that it's really your money. And that your love, the compassion that sometimes we try to shut off, is a compassion that comes from you. It's a desire that you're placing in us to use some of your money to help those who are in financial need, who are struggling. Father, I pray that you'll direct us, you'll change our eye focus, that we'll look, and Lord, that we'll also be prepared to meet that need. I pray, Father, that we will meet the challenge, that, Lord, we might in that occasion have confident assurance that you're working in our lives and that we can ask you for more. And Lord, we would pray that you might make us the kind of people that you can trust with riches, If you give us the resources, we will use them for your glory. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.